Have you ever stared up at the night sky and felt mesmerized by the seemingly endless blanket of stars? At first, they may all look silver or white, but with a telescope or even a good pair of binoculars, something amazing happens. The stars begin to show their true colors, literally. Some glow with a bluish tint, others burn a deep orange or red. You've already met a couple of these colorful stars earlier in the course. Rigel, a blazing blue supergiant, and Betelgeuse, a red supergiant. Remember that a star's color can give us all sorts of information. It can act like a billboard, advertising the star's exact size, luminosity, and temperature. It can even tell us where the star is in its life cycle. Today we'll start with the most familiar star to us, the Sun, and see how what we already know about the Sun can help us unlock the secrets of the other stars in our night sky. We've spent time exploring the Sun's layers, from the super-hot core to the outer corona, and we've seen how nuclear fusion at its center turns hydrogen into helium, releasing a massive amount of energy. That fusion is what makes the Sun shine, and that's not just a solar thing, it's a stellar thing. Every star in the universe produces energy the same way. But what does it take to be considered a star? While our culture may have a different definition, scientifically, a star is a giant ball of hot gas in space that emits light and heat through nuclear fusion. And scientists estimate that there are around 1 septillion stars in our universe, our Sun representing just one of them. While the Sun might feel like a pretty big deal to us, in stellar terms, it's actually pretty average. Not the biggest, not the brightest, and certainly not the oldest. That's part of what makes it such a great model for studying stars in general. It's very typical. Everything you've already learned about the Sun applies to stars across the universe, so you've got a great head start on this topic already. For example, the layers of the Sun? Other stars have them too. The dramatic surface activity? Yup, sunspots, flares, solar wind, they're not unique to our Sun. And nuclear fusion, where a little bit of mass gets converted into a whole lot of energy thanks to Einstein's famous equation, E equals mc squared, this process powers every star that you see in our night sky. How do we even know all of this about stars we'll never visit? Do you remember learning about spectroscopy? When we pass starlight through a spectroscope, we get a rainbow of colors with tiny dark lines. Those lines are like chemical barcodes, telling us exactly which elements are in a star's atmosphere. It's how we read starlight to figure out what stars are made of. Scientists have been able to use all of this information to piece together how stars live and die. Let's take a look. When you see that blanket of stars spread across the night sky, are you seeing something that is static and unchanging? Or are you just seeing a snapshot of what the universe looks like right now? While stars aren't alive in the way people or animals are, they do go through a life cycle. They're born, they live, and eventually they die. So if you were to come back to your favorite stargazing spot in a few billion years, you'd likely see a very different set of stars in the sky, and have to invent a whole new set of constellations to match. We'll look more closely at how stars are born and die in upcoming lessons, but today we'll focus on the main sequence stage of a star's life. This is the longest phase of a star's life cycle, when it's a normal adult star living its best life. This is also when the star is steadily fusing hydrogen into helium in its core, and this can last for millions to billions of years, depending on the star's size. Most of the stars we see in the night sky, including some of the most famous ones, are in this main sequence stage right now. Let's connect the dots between what we see when we look at a star and what's actually going on inside it. First up, color. Some stars glow blue or white, others orange or yellow, and some burn a deep red. And this color is directly tied to temperature. You may have some experience with this correlation if you've watched the flame from a gas stove. Notice how the flame starts off blue from the source, where it's the hottest, but then it begins to turn red as it is cooled from the air around it. So blue stars are much hotter than red stars. But there's more. A star's luminosity, how much energy it gives off, also depends heavily on its temperature. If a blue star is hotter than a red star, which one do you think is brighter? Hotter stars tend to be more luminous, so blue stars give off more total light than red stars. Now, let's bring in size, and here's where it all starts to click. Among the main sequence stars, there's a clear relationship between color, temperature, luminosity, and size. The largest main sequence stars are hot, blue, and bright, while the smallest are cool, red, and dim. Okay, that cool might be an overstatement, as there are still thousands of degrees, but it's all relative. Let's take a look at how astronomers use this relationship to classify stars. Do you remember what type of visible light stars give off? They actually emit white light, which simply means that they emit all of the wavelengths of light. But based on their temperature, certain wavelengths will be just a little more dominant than others, making the hottest stars appear blue, while others appear yellow and orange, and the coolest stars appear red. Stars are classified according to their color, size, and temperature, and each group is given a corresponding letter. The largest and hottest main sequence stars are blue giants, also known as O-type stars. Just below these are the B and A-type stars, which become more white in color. O, B, and A-type stars are all massive, extremely hot, and incredibly bright. These stars have short, dramatic lifespans and tend to end violently. Moving down the scales for size and temperature, we find the F and G-type stars. They glow with a yellow hue and are in the middle of the spectrum in terms of luminosity and temperature. At the smallest end of the chart are the K and M-type stars. These stars are small, cool, and faint, but they're the most common type in the universe. They burn fuel slowly and live incredibly long lives. But this classification system only works for stars that are part of the main sequence group, which simply means stars that are in the normal part of their adulthood. Stars near the beginning or end of their lifespans won't show these predictable relationships between color, size, and temperature. For example, red giants and supergiants, such as Betelgeuse, are older stars that have cooled and expanded. They're large and bright, even though they are cool and red. White dwarfs, like Sirius B, show just the opposite anomaly. They are the leftover cores of stars that have used up their fuel. Even though they are small and dim, they are extremely hot and white. So where do you think the sun fits in? Think about the color it appears in our sky, as well as what you know about how it compares to other stars. Pause the video for a moment and predict the group you think it would most likely be placed in. Our sun is a yellow G-type star. In the next few lessons, we'll learn more about its birth and eventual death. But right now, it's just busy living its life as an average main sequence star. Not too big, and not too small. Across our universe, billions of other stars are doing the exact same thing, fusing hydrogen into helium and creating enormous amounts of light and heat as they do. Maybe some of them are even warming planets similar to ours. With a septillion stars out there, the possibilities seem almost endless. Well, that's it for today, explorers. Keep stargazing, and remember that each point of light you see in our night sky is another sun that's probably a lot like ours. See you next time! Hey!